let it rain.
Open the floodgates of heaven.
The Lord reigns. Let the earth be glad. Let the distant shores rejoice. Clouds and thick darkness surround him. Righteousness and justice are the foundation of his throne. Fire goes before him and consumes his foes on every side. His lightning lights up the world. The earth sees and trembles. The mountains melt like wax before the Lord. Before the Lord of all the earth, the heavens proclaim his righteousness, and all peoples will see his glory. Oh, we want to see your glory, God. Oh, God, we want to see your glory. You want to see his glory? Lift your voices. Lift your hands. We want to see your glory, God. Oh, send down your power. Oh, God, send your glory. We want to see you move in our generation, oh, God.
Hallowed be thy name.
Hallowed be thy name.
Serve this morning. Are you blessed by that music? Let's clap to the Lord for Lydia and the team. Thank you so much. Now turn to your Bibles in the book of Matthew chapter 16 verse 26. What I'm doing during this season is to deal with certain areas that are going to help you and me go very strongly with the Lord in the direction he has called us to go. And so I'm making a commitment to some areas. Some of them are pretty challenging to deal with because of the amount of study I have to make, but that's why we are called to serve. Matthew 16 verse 26.
Matthew chapter 16 verse 26 says, "What good will it be for a man if he gains the whole world, yet forfeit his soul? Or what can a man give in exchange for his soul?"
The heading of our teaching this morning is separated from the world. I would like you to put that down because that is a very, very critical aspect of this journey. Separated from the world. There are some words in the Bible which are a bit tricky to pursue or to understand or to practice, but it is necessary for us to understand them. Some of these words, the Bible gives us instructions in two different directions on the same word. And so if you are not careful, you may lean on one end of the equation and forget the other side. One of these words is the word world. The word world. The Bible says, don't love this world, for the love of the world is bad. The same Bible says, for God so loved the world. So it becomes a bit confusing if you're not careful. So what you want to do is to find out what really is the scripture referring to. In giving two instructions in opposite directions using the same word. Therefore, in a few minutes, I would like us just quickly show you what this word world means. These notes are at the door for those of you who are keen students of the Bible. I do this for those of you who are keen on studying the Bible and being able to minister to people. The first interpretation from Hebrew of the word word is G-E, ge. Ge actually is the earth, the ground, the land, or the terrestrial sphere different from the heavens. The earth, the land, the ground, and the terrestrial sphere different from the heavens. That is called world. You can find examples, I've given examples in these notes. Well, one of them is Matthew 5, verse 13, which says, you are the salt of the earth. You see, you are the salt of the earth. Talking about the land where we are. Number two word is pretty difficult for me to pronounce. It's oikoumene, O-I-K-O-U-M-E-N-E, O-I-K-O-U-M-E-N-E. This word means peoples or inhabitants. It is translated world, but it actually means peoples or inhabitants of the earth. You can find that in Acts 17 verse 31, Psalm 33 verse 8, Isaiah 34 verse 1 and 2, and other scriptures. Word number three is A-I-O-N, A-I-O-N, Oyon. Now, the word Oyon means an age. That word is interpreted world. It means an age. It also means an epoch or a period of time. So it talks about the world. At times, it's talking about an epoch or about a period of time. Now, you need to understand that so that you apply it correctly based on what it means. That's why, at times, you hear statements like this. The world and its chaos, the chaos of this world. That statement, this world, relating to chaos, talks about the epoch, an age. It talks about a period of time. You find a statement like this, the wisdom of this world. It's talking about the wisdom of the epoch or the period of time. It talks about the fashion of this world. You hear words like the gods of this world or the rulers of this world. All those, when you look at the Hebrew and the Greek, it is talking about an epoch or a period of time. It also talks about all these things, all the rulers of this world, the cares of this world, the wisdom of this world are all under judgment when the time comes. So when you see the word world, you've got to be careful what is referring to. Just one more, then we move on to the key. Another meaning is the most common word used defined world in Greek is the word cosmos. K-O-S-M-O-S or C-O-S-M-O-S. Now, cosmos explains, it comes out in various areas, and there are four of them. I want to bring them to you quickly. When it is interpreted cosmos, it means the following. It means the entire expanse of the created universe, structured with systematic order, harmony, and artistic beauty. The entire expanse of the created universe. Now, I don't want to dwell there because that's not what I wanted to deal with this morning. Talking about the entire expanse, the beauty of it, you find it in the book of Acts, chapter 17, verse 24. It says that God who made the world and all things in it, you know, the God who made the expanse and all the things in it, all the beauties, all the creatures, talking about the beauty of life and all that constitutes it. The second cosmos interpretation means temporal possessions. Temporal possessions. You find a statement like in Matthew 16 verse 26. What will a man profit if he gains the whole world? That statement, the whole world, actually talks about gaining temporal possessions. In other words, he's not condemning gaining things. Is making a reference to the power of those temporal things. That's why there are people who will do anything to gain wealth, including murder, worshiping demons, falsifying things, cheating and lying. And the scripture is saying there is a world out here. The world consisting of things, material things. So that is temporal possessions. That's another reference. The other reference of cosmos is the human race or mankind. And you find it in a book like Matthew 5 verse 14. You are the light of the world. You are the light of the world. You are the light of the people. Not just the world, but the light of the people in the world. So when you talk about world, it makes a reference to the people. And finally, the present moral and spiritual condition of human affairs in alienation from and in opposition to God. Now that statement is so critical. I'm combining it very carefully. Let me say it again. The present moral and spiritual condition of human affairs in alienation from and opposition to God. Are you there? Now, whatever is in opposition to God or in alienation from God, the Bible calls it cosmos, the world. You find a statement like in John 8:23, and he was saying to them, you are from below, I am from above. You are of this world, I'm not of this world. Now, he was here and he was speaking from here. Jesus was speaking from the earth. He was in the world, breathing oxygen like you and me, eating bread made from wheat. And yet he says, I am not of the world. You are of the world, but I'm not of the world. What is he referring to? He's referring to the moral condition, the moral state of the world. Please get this morning. Because when the Bible says be separate, we have to understand what is he talking about. Jesus says, I am in the world, but I'm not of the world. John 17, he says, they are not of the world just as I am not of the world. And yet he is on earth. We are still here, eating bread, breathing oxygen, drinking water. We function like humans. We have to sleep, to rest, to gain strength for the following day. What is he talking about here? He's talking about a certain condition, a moral condition of human affairs that is opposite God's purposes, that fights against God's intention. That is what he's referring to, this moral condition. Now, actually the scripture says this moral condition that fights God is under the prince of the world. You've seen that in your Bible somewhere. That is in 1 Corinthians 6, 2 verse 12. The prince of the world, the presence of the Antichrist. There is a moral condition around you and me governed by the prince of the world, that demonic system that the enemy uses to control human minds and direct them in a given direction. That moral condition is not driven by your feelings. It's driven by the prince of this world. The presence of the spirit of the Antichrist, according to 1 John 4, verse 5. There is a spirit of the Antichrist at work. Please get this. This spirit is so responsible for the manipulation of humanity that even believers, Christians, are doing things under the influence of this spirit. They're very good on Sunday, but go and see what they do at the place of work. There's something that is controlling the moral condition of our society. That's what the Bible talks about. The world. Be ye separate. Today, my friends, the world seems to be chaotic. Nations, kingdoms are shaken. I mean, there has never been a shaking of nations like now. Since, you know, Egypt was the first civilization in the world. You know that? The papyrus. Was it designed in Egypt for writing? Imagine, for the first time in history, nations are being shaken, including Egypt. Egypt has never been shaken. It's the first time. Economies are falling. Can you imagine America being downgraded? Can you imagine Italy and France? They're almost being downgraded in terms of the economic power. You go to the village. My villagers don't understand that language. They still plant sukuma wiki the same way. They don't understand the language of downsizing or downgrading. But there's something happening in the world. We used to run to America. We can't run there anymore. Run to Europe. We can't run there anymore because they're looking for help. Something is happening in the world. If we are not careful, this thing may hit even the holiest of us all. Let me ask you a question. Is this confusion strange? Or does God know about it? I believe He knows. Are you with me? I believe God knows. And then God makes a statement, says, come out, I'll show you some of those scriptures. Be ye separate. He's not saying, run out of the world, go and hide in some shimo in Yahururu. You remember that time when some people were building bangas? Remember that? I saw some Kenyans with the masks. I was like, what is going on with these people? Now, when you look at the Bible, there are many places we are commanded to separate from. Some of the terms are very technical in terms of spiritual warfare. Using the word Egypt most of the time. Babylon, Sodom. That's not my concern today. But looking at Egypt, the way the Jewish people came out of Egypt, is a very good example of our separation from the world. God told Moses, go and tell Pharaoh to let my children go free out of Egypt. My firstborn. I want him out of Egypt to go to the promised land. I want them out. Let them come out quickly and leave Egypt. Let them go to the promised land. You know what happened? Pharaoh played quite some games there. When you read Exodus, you discover it was not a very easy thing. Pharaoh tried to play with Moses and play with the children of Israel. And he even made very strong suggestions to them. When Moses became very persistent, I would like to read Exodus for me. Exodus 8, verse 25, and also Exodus 10, verse 24.
Exodus 8:25 says, then Pharaoh summoned Moses and Aaron and said, go, sacrifice to your God here in the land.
Here in the land. 10:24
says, Then Pharaoh summoned Moses and said, "Go, worship the Lord. Even your women and children may go with you. Only leave your flocks and herds behind."
Are you following me? Come on, say amen. I want your attention this morning because this is not the exciting kind of stuff. This is something that I think is calling for us to think along. And I want you to think along with me. Salvation is compared to the journey from Egypt to the promised land. Accepted? Come on, is that clear? Our salvation from sin to Jesus is compared to the journey of the children of Israel from Egypt to Canaan. Is that clear? Oh, come on. Is that clear? Now, having said that, their salvation from Egypt hinged on nothing but the blood, the Paschal lamb. The animal was killed, the blood was put on the lintels, and that blood alone on the lintels was enough to redeem them out of Egypt. They didn't come out because of the beauty of the lintels or the beauty of their houses. The killing angel did not bypass them because their doors were beautiful or the people in the houses were morally correct. The angel of death passed them because he saw the blood on the doorposts. So. The same thing happens to us. It's all about the blood of Jesus. Okay? Now, I want you to walk this journey because we're dealing with being separate. The blood of Jesus gets us out of the mess of this life, brings us out of the sin, the junk, the stinking we have been involved in. Now,